we have an available tool called corneal topography. This is latest generation, an altimetric, which serves to extrapolate a whole series of values, indexes, and figures relative to the cornea, which is an anterior segment of the eye. The corneal topographer is a machine that manages to encode everything that is transparent. It practically gives us information on the most anterior part of the eye. This is the one we can measure with an instrument equipped with cameras such as the topographer. This altitudinal topograph combines two technologies. The first technology, an ancient one, is that of Placido's discs. These concentric circles are projected onto the cornea and reflected by it, and the machine captures them through a camera that is in the center. The other technology is much newer and is that of the Scheimpflug camera, in which a rotating camera is able to capture a whole series of measurements relating to the front and transparent part of the eye. These measurements are captured by the computer and processed. This very sophisticated and very powerful machine is able to provide us with a whole series of measurements. A screen appears with a series of numerical values which the ophthalmologist must know how to read and interpret, and it is a real map of colors. This color map represents the surface of the cornea, and we can select a whole series of parameters. Usually, the corneal topography is used with 6 maps, in which the anterior and posterior surfaces of the cornea are represented: corneal thickness, anterior tangent, anterior sagittal, posterior, anterior, and posterior refractive elevation, and the space of the anterior chamber, and finally the background. Practically, this is what is photographed by the machine. This is Placido's disc with Placido's circles that are reflected. Depending on how they are reflected, the computer is able to interpret and define what is the radius of curvature of the cornea. The smaller the reflected circles are, the more the cornea is curved. The larger the reflected circles are, the more the cornea is flat. This is the principle on which the Placidum disc is based on. It provides a corneal topography that can be tangential, anterior, or front axial depending on the type of computer processing. However, it still gives us an answer of what is the shape of the cornea in the sense of curvature, which is the radius of curvature at that point of the cornea. If we look at it in 3 dimensions, we see how the cornea in a healthy subject like this is represented as fundamentally spherical and a little more curved on one axis and a little more flat on the other, because it is an astigmatic patient. Fundamentally, it is green and a little bit redder in the center. The corneal topography is expressed in the diopters. Here, on the left, the color scale is represented, in which there are the coldest colors that show the flattest part of the cornea. The intermediate colors represent the intermediate part, and the warmer colors represent the most curved part of the cornea. Therefore, we have a cornea that is flatter in the periphery, the outer part, which then goes to merge with the white part of the eye that is flatter, while the central part is more curved. Looking at it in 3 dimensions, we see that this part is flatter and this is more curved. And this has the purpose of making the cornea as spherical, not spherical. It is not an ideal sphere, but more curved in the center and flatter in the periphery. This concept is very important because if it were spherical, we would not see well. Being as spherical, it can eliminate aberrations which are high-grade defects and give almost perfect vision quality. This is the processing of the anterior cornea in diopters, that is, in curvature radii. In the same way, the machine can give us the front elevation, which is a more difficult concept. Now, the scale is zero green, then the red is plus and blue is minus expressed in microns. We have to imagine that a computer takes the mean curvature radius of the cornea, builds an ideal sphere that represents green, which is the average of the curvature of the cornea, puts this sphere ideally resting on the cornea, and draws everything that comes over the ideal cornea in red colors, and everything else comes under the ideal cornea in blue values. In practice, it is like having a geographical model in which the sea is represented in blue because it is deeper, and the mountains are represented in red. This is also a normal eye. It is a classic form of a healthy cornea, a little astigmatic, but otherwise absolutely perfect in anterior elevation. The same thing can be done with the posterior cornea, that is, with a face of the cornea looking towards the inside of the eye. Seen in three dimensions, we can understand that the posterior cornea is curved in this central green portion. Then later, it has two parts, the blue ones, in which the cornea is further back than the ideal cornea, and the red ones, in which the cornea is more advanced than the ideal one. This is artificial, because in reality, it is not so. There is no ideal cornea. That is, the machine makes a measurement of the curvature rays, takes these curvature rays, and transforms them into an ideal sphere, which is considered as the green one. It is as if our ideal sphere intersected the cornea only in the green area, and all that is blue is found below, and all that is red is found above. This is an altimetric representation possible only with an altimetric topographer that combines the disk with the capture of images with a Scheimpflug image. Then, recapitulating the anterior tangential elaborated in marginal sense or in sagittal sense, in which only the level of definition changes. The same thing can be done for the posterior cornea, the one that looks towards the inside. Elevation maps, where the cornea is compared to a sphere, and everything above or below is represented with a color scale or second type. Then, there is the anterior, posterior, and equivalent refractive elaboration, in which the fact that the cornea is considered in each point a diopter, that is, a lens with a given power in that given point, is taken all into consideration. Another very important type of processing of the corneal topography is the thickness, because if we have the anterior and posterior altimetry making a difference between these, we can understand how thick the cornea is, because it is in three dimensions. Therefore, we have a map in front elevation, a map in rear elevation, and then we have a map in the thicknesses. As can be seen from this representation, this corneal thickness, also called pachymetry, the thicker the cornea is, the more one goes to the periphery. The blue colors are represented in the most peripheral part of the cornea, and the thinner it is, the more goes towards the center, and the thinnest point is represented here. This is very important because the corneal thickness is one of the parameters, together with the curvature and relative height of the cornea, to determine whether the cornea itself is healthy or sick. Thin corneas may hide a pathology such as keratoconus, while too thick corneas may hide a corneal endothelial disease. The topographer also allows us to see the anterior chamber. Behind the cornea, which is transparent, there is the iris and then the crystalline. Since the cornea is transparent, the topographer manages to measure the space that divides the cornea from the crystalline iris plane. This space is represented in millimeters. This is our eye in section. This is the crystalline through the pupillary foramen. This is the dark iris, and this is the cornea. The space between the posterior surface of the cornea and the anterior surface of the crystalline iris plane is called anterior chamber. It is in the shape of a crescent-shaped sickle, and obviously it is deeper in the central area and becomes thinner in the peripheral zone. This machine is also able to provide the image capture film in which we see in all the various meridians the development of the anterior chamber. There is a whole series of indexes which are these numbers and are fundamentally pertinent to the ophthalmologist. But each of these numbers, and a number that has been measured by this sophisticated machine, serves the ophthalmologist for calculating the lens in a cataract surgery, for the calculation of a phakic lens in an operation of reduction of myopia, for a laser operation per se. In short, this is the basic exam that is done in an eye study to understand the state of the anterior segment of the eye. This happens regardless of the state of the patient. Therefore, a patient who goes for a normal eye examination and is subjected to this examination has the possibility of knowing a whole series of parameters relating to the health of his eye.